Hi, we're missing one board member. It might be a parking issue. So a few words before we get going. We have a lot of information to cover in 2 hours, and I really appreciate all of you turning out. What we're going to try to do is devote at least a half hour of time to questions, but we'd like you to keep your questions until the presentations have concluded, because there's a lot of material to cover and we are not open-ended on time. This night has many, many mandated activities by statute that we have to get through. It's a big night for the school district, so bear with us. So even though Sal isn't here yet, I know he's familiar with this, so we're going to get underway. So the first thing we're going to do is cover the middle schools and the high school, and then we're going to have time for questions. And I might try to ascertain the character of the crowd. What we'll probably try to do is minimize the amount of time you speak. So while we usually have a 3-minute rule, we're fine with 1 minute, you know, if you can kind of boil it down, because more people can speak. The other thing is that we would prefer that you not repeat something that's already been said. We're not going to literally count how many people say it. We just want the issues out there in front of us. And if I have 10 con or 10 pro, whatever it is, statements, I'll ask for a representation of another side so that we get as even as we can. And if you have spokespeople, that's great too. And we might just have a show of hands. We don't like rushing this any more than you do, but we're probably going to be here till midnight with all we have to do, so bear with us. And then we have to get into closed session by 6:15 to do some business to get back out here at 6:30 and start all over again. So that said, I'm going to invite up, is Kevin's coming first? Okay. All right, did you have a question?
Yes, just to do the Pledge of Allegiance before we begin.
Oh, I'm sorry. My bad. I'm so anxious to get started that we have to have the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. Thank you for pointing that out.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God,
And while we're at it, can we have an announcement for Spanish translation? Oh, there you are.
Good evening. Buenas tardes. Si hay alguien que necesita traducción, is there anybody in need of translation?
Thank you. Okay, Kevin, all yours.
Good evening. Thank you for letting us come talk tonight. This is kind of exciting for us. This is we've been working on this since 2011, and so it's fun to update this and revisit these and start seeing some of these projects come to light over the next few years. So kind of remind everyone why we're here and what a master plan is. It really is a 25,000 foot look at each school, so we can create a roadmap of where the school's going to head in over the next 10, 15 years. To make sure that we place buildings in the appropriate spots, and so that it can help establish and work with the educational program. And the main thing that we want to talk about with a master plan is just remember that we're establishing a shared vision of the physical development of the campus environment. So kind of talk about the process. We met with all the charter schools, the elementary schools, and middle schools back in 2011 and developed the master plans. We did this over a series of 4 meetings. And during those meetings, we came up with their master plans and came up with their priority list. At the high school, we waited till the fall of 2014 to start this process. And then Creekside, we never did this process until this time. So this is a brand new process for Creekside. We came back this past spring over a series of 3 meetings to look at the master plans again at all 11 campuses. The first meeting was just to check in with all the schools to make sure there and see if there's any changes to the actual changes to the master plan, and if there was, what they were. The second meeting was just to collect their priority list. So after the first meeting, they went back to all their different groups, DLAC, user groups, parents groups, and kind of came up with their priority list. So they presented that to us at the second meeting. And then the third meeting was a public presentation where we gathered more input and made revisions based on any input that we got. So this evening, we are looking for your guys' comments on the master plan and your input. We will not be talking dollar numbers tonight. There's a lot of information that's going to come real in a real quick time. So we want to just get everything out, and then we'll be looking at it at the next meeting on June 20th to look at the dollar numbers and when and where we're going to spend it. So I'm going to start off with Adele Harrison. This is the current site as it is with the soccer field. Thank you. With the soccer field here, the gym here, the admin, library, and the classrooms in the five portable buildings. The high school's up here. So the master plan for Adele really hasn't changed drastically since 2011, just the way we're executing it has. Currently, we are showing the new track, or new walking path and field that are going in currently. I know there's been some conversations about the fig tree and trying to preserve it. We have talked with arborists, and we still are looking at options. Talking with arborists, they have said fig trees generally bear fruit for about 50 years. After that, we can expect, they can still produce, but we can expect a loss of production. And we are looking at possibly replacing them as well. Fig trees are very fast growing trees and can bear fruit in about a year. So we are looking at ways to save it. We don't know if we possibly can, but we are looking at that, and we're looking for solutions for that. Also want to, since we're talking on the field, I just want to remind everyone that we are doing a cork infill on this. That was input that we got as the desired route to go is a 100% organic infill. So I want to just remind everyone that. Adele itself, their main concerns actually are around, their major concern is around their PE. Currently their boys' locker room is located in a portable. That's right about there. You can see it on the screen. Locker rooms and portables don't really agree with each other. We had to move that portable a few years ago to squeeze a classroom in, another classroom, and we ended up having to do quite a bit of work to that because the humidity that is created in a locker room, it just doesn't work. So they had a real strong desire to move the boys' locker room back into the PE building. By doing that, we would have to relocate their music and drama room from where it's currently located to a brand new addition to that gym. So it still has that direct access to their stage. They also want to update all their classrooms. If anyone's walked inside those classrooms, they feel really small because there's a whole bunch of wing walls that kind of cut up that space. Even though the classrooms themselves are the CDE recommended 960 square feet, the space where they can put desks is actually quite a bit smaller, so that space is really cramped. It's hard to walk around. So they would like to remove some of those wing walls and really open up the classrooms. They also, the hallways were originally designed to be breakout spaces where they could send groups of students out, because the classrooms have windows that look out onto those hallways. But the hallways themselves have all hard materials, hard floors, hard walls. There's no acoustical treatments in there, so it's impossible for them to use them as breakout spaces because the sound just reverberates back into the rooms. So would they like to look at doing some acoustical treatments to those corridors so they could actually use them for the ways that they were originally designed. And they'd also like to replace all their aging portables. Portables do have a lifespan, and they're about 25 years to 30 years, so these are starting to get towards the end of their lives because they were relocated, most of them from Altamira. And they'd also like to do additional additional site work down the bottom with some additional staff parking. So it's kind of in a large plan of the improvements with the two-story. We see a single classroom on the bottom, standard-sized classroom with restrooms, and a larger art room on the bottom, and then three standard classrooms above that is to replace all those portables. So the list that we got of priorities from from Adele. Like I said, it came not from just the administrator, it came from all their groups. Is mainly it's the big problems they were looking at, and the gym being the main issue, trying to get the boys' locker room back in there, trying to get a larger, better performing arts room, music room, and fixing the gym so it had a hardwood floor so it played like a real gym. And then to fix those classrooms and hallways, and then replace all the aging portables. Then the fourth item is something that you'll see quite often tonight, is technology. This is a common theme throughout every single school, is technology upgrades. So in the form of LCD projectors or front row systems, it was on everyone's list. And then doing some additional site works with the parking lot and stuff to the courtyards as well. So I'm going to pause between every school and give a chance for the trustees to ask questions about each school.
Yeah.
Very quickly, if we have a quick question, and then we're going to take comments after we get through the two middle schools and high school. We're going to have about a half hour or so.
And then break it in blocks. So, I mean, it seems reasonable. Yeah. So let's move on.
Unless. Right now.
Yeah.
Okay. So, as far as the safe, warm, and dry at Adele, you know, right, that stuff, there's what you're looking at here. We've already covered all the safe, warm, and dry there.
Correct.
Okay. Thanks.
Anything else? Okay. Okay, Altamira. Move on to there. This is Altamira as it is today. We have done quite a bit of work at Altamira since 2011. We're touching on some of those warm, safe, and dries. We have re-roofed. We have modernized their gym. We have upgraded a whole bunch of their interior carpets. And it's on the books to replace all their heating and cooling next summer. So that's already in the works. Altamira, once again, didn't change drastically from 2011. There's still a strong desire to give Altamira its own identity from a Woodland Star, to try to give a separation so each school has their identity. That was a common theme for both schools. In this rendition, we move the fire lane to try to separate the two. You'll see a different one when we get to Woodland Star. I'm showing you this one because this is the slide we showed to Altamira. They haven't seen the revised one that we got after we got input from Woodland Star. The main thing that changed from 2011 to this one, since we have done a lot of their warm, safe, and dry, is there was a strong desire to really fix their athletic facilities, mainly their track and field. They saw that as being unsafe, and they needed more of PE space. Right now, if it rains, the day after, a couple days after, they can't use those facilities because they are too muddy and too wet. So they want to be able to expand that so they can have the health and wellness of their students. They mainly looked at this as being one of their top priorities because they are very happy with their classrooms as they are now. So they weren't focusing so much on the actual classrooms themselves. Some of the stuff that still remains on their list is modernizing the locker rooms. These locker rooms have not been modernized. They're still original from 1960s. So they are in definitely need of some improvements. Same thing with the library. It was the only other building that has not been modernized. They're fairly happy with the library, but it could use some touch-ups. It's really low on their priority. And they also had a strong desire to add on to their administration currently, because their staff break room and staff work room are in the library building, and they'd like to bring those back over to the admin. And they also like to use, right outside the gym itself, there's a large covered area. And there's a building that was built sometime, looks like in around the 1980s, we can't find any drawings for it. That was the old cafeteria that was under there. And it's just being used as storage right now. So we'd like to remove that and really open up that space and open up the skylights that have been covered up to really give a large covered area that students could use on rainy days for outdoor eating. It's a big item for a really small cost, so we're projecting to see a pretty small cost for that. And then there's also ADA work that we definitely have to do around that campus. So just kind of remind you, when we hear that word necessary or mandatory, those are stuff we have to do once we touch something. It's not something we have to do right away as the first project out, but it's something we have to do when we touch a building. So when Will took all this to his DLAC and to his parents' groups, these are the list they came up with. Like I said, their number one concern is their track and field as being in need of the most work. They felt it was dangerous and they needed more area for the health and wellness of their students to get out and exercise, because every student does PE, so they saw it as a big issue for all their students. And they also saw that strong need to have the staff come into the admin every day. So bringing that workroom, bringing that break room back into the admin was a big desire of theirs. And once again, technology was high on their list. And then it starts getting to some of the smaller items, and there a lot of them are cosmetic. Modernizing bathrooms, demolishing that stack bar that I talked about, renovating the locker rooms, doing additional parking. We're already doing a parking lot this summer, but they would need additional parking as well on the north side, where a lot of the classrooms actually are for their staff. And then they had a whole bunch of stuff that they saw that would be nice to do. These are the non-priorities, but they didn't see them as really stuff that was high on their list. Like I said, the library showed up on there. Even though it looks kind of worn down, they are very happy with the way their library looks right now and functions. It just could use maybe a little paint job and some new finishes, but they're overall happy with the way it performs. So any questions on Altamira?
Questions from the board on Altamira? We're good, we can all proceed.
Right. Sonoma Valley High School. So this is as it is currently, with the main classrooms at the top, the PE facilities over to the east, the Ag Farm to the southeast, and Adele. This was the master plan from 2015. When meeting with them again, there was no changes from the master plan. I'll kind of get into the weeds a little bit more so it's easier to read. To remind everyone, the colors, the yellow are buildings that we see as heavy modernization, so buildings that need a lot of work interiorly. The buildings that are brown are newer buildings, probably built in the last 20 years or so, that need some cosmetic work, nothing major, or have been modernized. And the red are all new buildings. So here we see all the science building, the J building, Colton Hall, and the drama music building is all needing to be major modernization. The J building was built in the early 2000s, 99, 2000. And so it just needs a little bit of work. And then in the center, we're showing a new quad. Currently, there's two buildings there. So there's the G buildings and all the F portables. The G buildings are buildings that are from around the 1950s. All the classrooms in that building are around 750 square feet, I believe they are. They're well below the CDE standards. You don't have to meet that standard, but it's a recommendation that CDE sets. Anything less than that, you start feeling really crowded in classrooms. So we're proposing to put a quad there and then replace those classrooms with a two-story classroom just to the south of that. And then on to the east side of that quad, making a new cafeteria, kitchen, and student service center. Below that would be the PE complex, since where the two-story classroom is, currently is the locker room. The locker rooms have been modernized a couple times, but are in need of rehab again. They are some of the most abused spaces that you can find on a high school campus. So at this point, it's best probably just to replace those and try to fix it again. So we're proposing to put new locker rooms and put them in with the new weight room. Weight room's well beyond its use, if anyone's been out there. and put in a cardio room and move the wrestling room over there as well. Just to the south of that would be a new pool. And then the pavilion we saw as a modernization as well. We're proposing to move the dance program there. They're pretty happy in Galton Hall, but we want to give them the opportunity to move into the pavilion so the whole PE complex could be together. The gym has been recently modernized last summer. We put a new wood floor in there. The bleachers in great shape. And we're proposing to build a new Hall of Fame in between the gym and the pavilion. This would house showcase all academic and athletic achievements of Sonoma Valley High graduates. It also housed some team rooms. So during basketball games or volleyball games, the students don't have to go all the way back over to the locker rooms. There's places for them to go during intermission. And the nice thing about putting it here is we can also provide a pedestrian crossover for people attending the games to use the restrooms that are in the pavilion, because currently the gym has no public restrooms. So now people can use it without actually have to leave the complex. And then the admin needs a little bit of work also with finishes and reorganizing some of the spaces in there to make it work a little bit better. At the front of the school, we see a heavy modernization to the shops to bring them up to 21st century shops, focusing on all the CTE and career-ready programs. And then at the entry to the school, we see that new 400-seat theater. The idea of having 400 seats is it could be also rented out to the public, but the main thing is we want to be able to get a full class, have the whole junior class come and listen to a speaker. And what we found are schools that do have these facilities, they aren't just used for performances, for plays, but these theaters get used almost 6 periods a day. So they do get used throughout the day, so they're not just for performances. Down the southeast corner is the Ag Farm. Currently there's two portables. We're proposing to remove those and do site-built classrooms. So there'd be two classrooms, conference rooms, a small kitchen in there for processing, and then a covered show arena so the students can practice showing their animals. This is something they have to do when they go to the fair. They have to run them through. So they want to be able to practice that or bring in students or 4-H to come and demonstrate how to do it. So it's both for them to learn how to do it and to showcase what they've learned. Just to the west of that are the existing barns. We're not planning to do anything to those barns, so they're going to remain as is. Just to the north of that, we're proposing to relocate the ag mechanics out of the shop area and move it onto the ag. So if they're working on farm equipment, tractors, whatnot, it makes sense to have it out at the ag farm itself. So they're not walking across campus to go between classes, and they can test what they've worked on as well. And then it's developing of that site around there. To the south, we're gonna create an outdoor classroom around the raised planter beds. This is once again so they can bring in elementary school kids and demonstrate how a garden works and have additional planting beds for themselves. Expand the vineyard all the way out towards the creek. And then they had a strong desire to create some seasonal planting. And they also wanted to do a little bit of a hay farm so they don't have to keep bringing in hay. They learn how to grow it and learn how to process it and they can feed their own animals with it. Then over on the east side, we are proposing to put in the orchard. They wanted a whole bunch of different trees out there. We saw the east side being the ideal location as it's a good visual block as well. So we saw that as the ideal place to put the orchard. Then up at the northeast corner is the health and wellness area. We are proposing to relocate the track and the field from its current location over closer to the creek. A couple reasons is we're moving as far away from houses as we can. The track and field should always be in a north-south access, mainly so players aren't running into the sun, both on the track and on the field. So putting in that north-south direction is the correct orientation. especially with track. If you have that strong westerly wind, if you're having a track meet and you have a strong wind and you're aiming to, you know, go on to NCS and you have a strong wind, you're not going to be able to because it's going to be a wind aided run. And so it doesn't count. So with that north-south access, you won't have that issue. Also with this reconfiguration, currently there's two softball fields and one baseball field. We can actually get two baseball fields and two softball fields. So we can get two baseball fields at the top, two softball fields, and some more landscape breaks behind some seating there at the track. Also, it allows us to keep three youth soccer fields that overlap those, so they can still stay open to youth soccer that currently use it. The center would have a synthetic field, much like what we're putting in over at Adele this summer. Then we see an 8-lane track with a 9-lane straightaway. We need the 8 lanes for to host an SCL. And then we see seating. We have seating on both sides, and we are currently showing lighting as well, and with field houses and concessions out there as well. We're replacing all the basketball courts and putting them just south of the walkway that comes off of Denmark. So when we met with the staff, and they came back with all their groups as well, their priorities were first was finish what's already under the works. We are working on the College and Career Center. We're putting it into the library building this summer. So they would like to finish that, modernizing the library and turn it into a true media center library and bringing it up to a 21st century high school library. They want to continue the work at the Ag Farm. That's a program that's growing, and they would like to support it. The CTE programs, the shop spaces, to work on the career ready. They want to continue on those. They see a strong desire to have those as being the forefront projects. Then they would like to upgrade the athletic facilities as being number two. There's a lot of issues out there with the track right now in its current condition. They have worked on it a lot and have worked really hard to keep it manageable, open, but that only lasts so long, and it's really at the end of its useful life. Same thing with the fields. We've heard numerous times that people get injured out there with the holes that are out there from rodents. So they really want to have that fixed up. Third was a pool. They really want a pool back on campus. And then fourth, there was their science building. Currently, the science rooms, they straddle two buildings, and so they would like to try to create a stronger connection and bring those two science classrooms that are in the J building up to the standards that are in the other classroom building as well. And then athletic facilities, getting replacing those locker rooms. 5, 6, and 7 are in this order because they are what we call the domino projects. 5 has to happen, 4, 6 can happen. 6 has to happen, 4, 7 can happen. So that's why those are in that order. And then Golden Hall and the Performing Arts and the admin are the next on their list. Those are the lower priorities for them. Any questions on Sonoma Valley High?
I just point out that it's not that no one on the board cares, but we've pretty much seen this presentation and asked a lot of questions. So we want to allow time for you guys too. So thank you.
And just as my understanding is how we're going to structure it is we're receiving the presentation, asking questions that we have as a board members prior to that, receiving public comment, and then deliberating. So it's a 1, 2, 3, 4.
Right. And we'll get public comment. Excuse me, if there are no questions about Creekside from the board, or even if there are, after that we'll have an interlude for public comment, and then we'll come back again.
Thank you.
So Creekside High, like I said, they didn't go through this process the first two times, so we did include them on this go-around of the master planning. To remind everyone where it is, it's on the very north end of Sonoma Valley High. They are actually fairly happy with their facility. There is definitely stuff that needs to be improved. Mainly is there's a lot of acoustical issues with privacy. They have some partition walls that aren't full height, so when they're trying to have confidential conversations. They can't because the sound travels over those walls. So they'd like to add full height walls in the entry in their lobby to create a new office. Currently, this whole space right here is their counseling. So we would like to break that up so we make a regular size office, make a break room for their staff so the staff can be removed from the students, because currently they pretty much have to share the same space as the students so they don't really get a break, and create a little breakout space outside of those. Fix up their main multi-use space, removing some cabinetries and adding a large storage room at the back end of it to make up for that space that we lost. And they'd really like to work on their site. This is kind of their open area. It's in the very back of their campus. Right now it's surrounded by a vinyl cladded chain link fence. Not the most welcoming for their students. Their students have commented that they kind of feel like they're in jail back there. And so we'd like to remove that fence and open it up by doing some landscape barriers to kind of give that edge, soften it up, and really dress up this area and make it something a place they actually want to be in. The only fence that would remain would be around their garden. Don't see any changes that really need to happen to it, but they would like to add an outdoor kitchen to it. So we're showing a new outdoor kitchen so they can prep food and cook out there if they want to. And we'd also like to add some more landscaping solid features at the south end of it, because they do want a distinction between what is Sonoma Valley High and what's Creekside, but to do it without building the fences. So add some landscape features that really kind of signify which side is Sonoma Valley High and which side is Creekside. So they have a pretty small list, but I think it can make a pretty good impact. So any questions about Creekside?
Well, good. So I won't waste time by going over the rules again, but we'd like to open this to public comment right now, and then we'll come back to the board. We're doing pretty well for time, and probably when you have questions, Kevin will be jumping in. We're having so much fun, we forget to speak into the microphone, so we might have to remind you to do that so the vast viewing audience at home can stay with us. So if someone would like to come up and start in with questions, we'll try to...
Questions or comments?
Okay. Yeah.
Can I put this down?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if you would, just tell us your name and...
Sure.
And then start speaking. Now, you will see the lights come on, and it'll let you know when you're at 2.5 minutes. Oh, you moved it to 1. Okay, yeah.
Oh, you did?
Okay, so all you have to do is talk a
little
faster.
I'm going to talk like an auctioneer.
Okay, there you go.
I'm Stephanie Jordan. I'm the parent of 2 kids in the schools, one at Adele and one at the high school. And I'm an employee of the district. I'm a school psychologist. I'm a coach in the community, a soccer coach. And I'm also a neighbor that lives in the neighborhood around Presswood and the high school. I am in full support of redeveloping the athletic fields. If everyone could just raise your hand or a sign if you're in full support of new athletic fields at the high school, that would be great. I think it's fair to say Sonoma High has the worst athletic facilities of any high school in Sonoma County or neighboring counties. And this would include other small towns with similar or presumably even fewer resources. The recent change of moving boys soccer to the winter season has really brought this issue to the fore. Our district has no turf field, no lights, and no stadium. Arnold Field is in sad shape and simply cannot accommodate wet weather conditions. Our soccer boys played their home games on a rented field in Petaluma, and when poorly drained fields were drenched due to winter rains, they practiced on the school blacktops. Senior night, a community event anticipated by all, had to be held away in Sebastopol. Despite these poor conditions, our JV and varsity teams had great seasons, and the JV team went undefeated with no home fans to cheer them on. I'm sure you're all well aware that the girls' soccer will move to winter next year as well, and they will share this burden. I have an obvious bias towards soccer, but we know that all of the outdoor sports facilities are in dire need of updates. Track, softball, baseball, all of it. As for the neighbors that border the high school fields who are in opposition to the project, I believe there are more neighbors who are in support of it than who oppose it. I live on Oak Lane, right at the intersection of MacArthur, almost directly in front of Presswood School. There are people that park in front of my house every single day to drop kids off or go to soccer games on weekends. And certainly whatever activities are going on at the high school in terms of games will impact me, and I welcome it. Because the schools were there first, and that's why I bought there. And I believe that great schools, and especially great schools with great facilities, will only raise our property values. I'll speak very briefly as an educator and a school psychologist. Exercising and participating in organized sports have immeasurable benefits to our students, and I can't imagine that I have to convince anyone here why we need to support school sports and our student athletes. Our community voted to pass Measure E, and what better way to give back to our voters than by putting in new fields that will be enjoyed for so many by so long, and not just by student athletes, but by the many youth organizations that use our school facilities. We have a lot of young athletes here tonight, especially some little ones, and I really hope this gets started before they enter high school. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, yeah, I'm Chuck Brown. I live on MacArthur Lane, and we've lived here about 11 years. We don't have children in the schools, but I have been volunteering in the schools the whole time we've been here, so I'm familiar with the schools. I would want to propose that modifying Arnold Field, improving Arnold Field, should be a very viable alternative to constructing and maintaining a new football stadium. But this idea has always been rejected out of hand, saying because we don't own, or the school district doesn't own Arnold Field, the county does. But surely something could be done about that. A joint powers agreement, even a sale, because I don't think that the county would drive a hard bargain. I think they would be very friendly to the idea. So I'm just saying that that idea, I think, needs to be very seriously investigated. I don't think it has been up to now. And I'll just add one thing I wasn't going to say, simply that we're talking about the poor condition of the athletic fields. I think everybody agrees they have to be fixed. But building a stadium with lights and bleachers for a varsity team, I think, has to be separated. It should be a separate item, because that's different than making it possible for all students to take part in athletics. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Don Jeffries. My wife and I live on Brockman Lane, and we are very big supporters of the school, very big supporters of the school system. We moved here from a very small community in Los Angeles called Oak Park, who had its own school district. Our property values were significantly raised because of the educational value, the educational potential that came from the Oak Park schools. So we definitely understand what a 21st education does, not only for the property values, but more importantly for the overall community, how it benefits the overall community. Now, I know that when Measure E was discussed, there was identified $210 million in needs, so a significant number of needs. You got basically half of that money. So my question is going to go toward making sure that we're maximizing the dollars that are made available. So in the marketing and advertising of the bond, the money was to use to make the school safe, warm, and dry for 21st century learning. Here's a direct quote from the bond information in 2016. Our focus is on warm, safe, and dry technology and the 21st century classroom. My assumption is that the expenditure of $8 to $10 million on a football stadium would take money away from significant building improvements that would truly support teaching and learning. Now, in the presentation, the non-priorities weren't listed for the high school. So my question would be, what educationally oriented facilities and initiatives designed to move this district's instructional capability into the 21st century goes unfixed or lacks upgrading because you're taking second place to building a new facility when alternatives are possible? So that's my question to the board. you're given a rare opportunity with a significant amount of money. Your mandate is to maximize those dollars in the best way to drive, as you said, the 21st century classroom. So thank you.
Thank you.
Ken Brown. My daughter is a sophomore now at Sonoma High. My grandson, Anthony, will be coming from Altamira, where Luann was class president. I learned at the ceremony the other day. I saw the presentation that we just had, and in there was a word, inspiring. And what I find inspiring now at Adele is the fig tree that's out in that field. And the fig tree is right next to Nathanson Creek. For me, I would appreciate a time out on that part of your plan. The effects and ramifications of that kind of field that they want to put in there are significant and need to be looked into. 2011 is a long time ago. Things change. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name's Rick Wickland. I have a letter here. There was a letter that my wife, Jane, wrote to the board on May 1st and delivered via email, and I think you're all familiar with that. And I just want a little bit of an update. This will only take a minute to read. Today's IT stated there will be athletic proponents and neighborhood opponents attending this meeting. My wife and I say the IT missed the mark. We are here as proponents for school and education for all the students. This is the reason we need to be here, and I believe what we voted for. Athletics and neighborhoods are important, but the focus needs to be on providing the best classroom education for all students. That includes those more academically inclined, those interested in performing arts, those desiring to develop their valuable trade skills, as well as those who wish to enrich their high school time with exercise and athletics. It is the school's responsibility to provide the best education to meet all the students' needs. We are excited and encouraged that the Sonoma Valley High School has funding for the facilities. As I'm sure everyone agrees, the school is in great need of improved facilities for the students. The current situation is one of years of deferred maintenance and an aging facility. Therefore, the top priority for projects at Sonoma Valley High must be related to education, including the new science wing, the new classroom building, the shop, meeting all health and safety standards, and bringing the school's technology into the 21st century, as was stated in Measure E ballot. Next in priority and in equal consideration should be the performing arts facility and improving athletic facilities. The school needs to have its pool back. We need a track that supports track meets. We need fields for sports such as soccer, baseball, football. We don't need a 2,500-seat stadium. That's expensive and way overbuilt. Even Bill Hoban in the IT says only 600 to 800 people are ever at Arnold Field. There are much less expensive alternatives, and we beseech the board to pursue them. We have funding for many improvements, but perhaps not all. Again, education is a school's top priority. Let's use the funds wisely and well to prepare all the students for the best future possible. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Rick, I just want to tell you that you finished exactly at 3 minutes. I really appreciate that.
Hi, I'm Selma Blanus. I was the campaign chair for Measure E, and I really appreciate all the hard work that the schools and the board are doing, and of course appreciate so much support from the community to have had overwhelming support for our bond measure. It is a difficult decision when we have so much deferred maintenance on every campus, and we want to give the students so much. I am, pleading to have as much of a thoughtful process to as many things as we can possibly give the kids, realizing that, you know, better school facilities, better athletic facilities improve not only their pride of community and sense of place, but increase attendance and increase their motivation and the academic achievement, not only for the moment, but also our entire town as we look into the future. The only thing I would like to also add for the plans is to also please add some security so that when we have these beautiful facilities that people don't come and take down the basketball hoops and stuff like that.
Thank you.
So I'm Nate Jordan. We are all members from the JV soccer team at Sonoma High, and we're all students there. We had a great season last year. We went undefeated, but we had no hometown or home field to play on because in the rain we couldn't play because it got really muddy and trashed. Oh, my God.
Good time.
You're doing a great job.
So we went undefeated, and we don't, oh my God, can I just restart? All right. We're all members of the high school JV soccer team. We had a great season and went undefeated, but we had to play our home games in Petaluma with no hometown fans to cheer us on because our home field, we couldn't do in the rain. So Sonoma High needs a turf field with lights. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Okay. Hello again. I was here a couple months ago for Student of the Year of Adele Harrison. I'm an incoming freshman, and I love to play sports, and I know a lot of the kids here do too. So a lot of the people keep saying, like, it's not good for the houses around there and stuff like that, but they bought the houses there with the school already there, so we have to give to the school a little. And then it will keep kids out of trouble if they keep playing sports. And then people would probably attend more games if the facilities were nicer and maybe they could see with lights. And then we would also have, we would be able to hold championships there because we haven't been able to because our stadiums have, or fields, whatever, haven't been up to standards. So, I mean, that's kind of sad. We had to go elsewhere and not have our home court there. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Erin Klein. I live over on Speck Road. I have three children. I have a graduate of Sonoma Valley High. I have one who chose to go to Justin Siena, and I have a junior. And I'm not going to repeat everything that's been said, but something I heard was safety. When I asked my middle child who went to Justin, why did she go to Justin? She went to Justin, one of her reasons was the facilities here were so poor. And it comes at a cost, and I'm not talking about tuition. Her junior year, on an October morning, I got a phone call from her high school telling me she was in a head-on collision. Every time our children leave this town, we put them in jeopardy. Those gentlemen who just left here, we put their lives in jeopardy on these roads, and we know they are not safe. I saw a fatality the other day outside of Glory Ferrara. I don't want that to be our children, our grandparents, our babysitters. Think about safety. Luckily for me, my daughter, you would not believe it. If you wanted to see pictures of her car, she walked away after she was in the ER. Let's not have another tragedy. This community cannot have one. So think about safety, think about our children, and for those who don't want lights, The ordinance is 10 o'clock. I think you'll be okay. Thank you.
My name is Susie Gallo. This is my daughter, Mary. She'll be a sophomore at Sonoma Valley High School. My son will be a junior, so sadly, the majority of these improvements will not affect either of them. I'm here for the future students of Sonoma Valley and the future of our community. We recently launched a petition asking for support of your redevelopment plans. I know there are some tough decisions that you're going to need to make because, as it's been pointed out, we don't have enough money to do everything we want, but I trust our school board to make those difficult decisions for us. The petition has been largely a grassroots movement. It's hard to find online, but in spite of that, in less than 2 weeks, we have 400 signatures in support of your redevelopment plans. Many of the people who signed the petition also made comments. So Mary and I would like to share some of those comments with you.
One of them says, I believe our kids need athletic facilities that are safe and updated. Sports are important to a sense of belonging and community, not only for the kids in schools, but also the community.
This property is owned by the entire valley for the education and health of our children. It is not only our duty to provide quiet pastoral grasslands for neighbors. It is also not appropriate to prevent the public from parking on public streets.
I am very passionate about giving all of our children a place to practice and compete in. Compete in sports that are in our hometown. They deserve this. Team sports are vital to our youth. This is essential.
So I'm going to flip through here, or I'll definitely run over. But you can go online and look at this. I really feel strongly that all of our district facilities are in dire need of upgrades, which the passage of Measure E makes possible to some extent. Our district staff have to work extra hard in order to maintain the rundown school buildings and athletic facilities. Investing in our youth will yield increased morale among students and will keep more families from sending their children out of town for school and sports. These are not just athletes, but student athletes who are choosing to go out of town. Let's make the future of our community a priority and do this right. It's time for the students and athletes of Sonoma to have something to be proud of. Thank you.
Before you leave, do you have the website online where they can go?
I do.
Yeah, could you
yes.
tell us that?
There's a change.org petition, and if you search under Susie Gallo, that's probably the easiest way to find it. It's S-U-S-I-E. G-A-L-L-O, and I will email it to the board members that I have contact information for. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jack Boydell. I'm an incoming junior at Sonoma Valley High School next year. I play two sports here at the high school, and I've traveled to many, many schools, both league opponents and non-league opponents. Our facilities, in comparison to public high schools, with similar size and demographics, are clearly falling behind. As a community that historically rallies around its local high school sports, we deserve facilities that accommodate athletes and the fans. The hardworking mentality employed by athletes of all these programs should be reflected at the places where we play. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Yannique Phillips. Recognize some of you up there. I'm the instructional aide at Adele Harrison Middle School in the Horticulture Department, which is now called the Farm to Table. I am asking today that a pause to the artificial turf be seriously considered. And before people freak out, I have four children that have gone through the school system. Between them, they have played lacrosse, they've swam, tennis, skateboarding, several other sports. I'm not against sports at all, and I'm very much in favor of the high school field going immediately in. The reason for this 11th hour ask and consideration to halt the Adele field is for two reasons. In mid-April, Adele staff learned for the first time that our 80-year-old heritage fig tree was slated for bulldozing. Our horticulture students pick from this tree to make jam, fig ice cream that we share with all the Adele students on campus. We eat them fresh, we dehydrate them, and we enjoy them throughout the year. Ray Robledo, who's from Olive Tree Farms, recently evaluated the age of this tree at 80 years old. He said it can be transplanted with a 90% success rate in the fall or winter. If transplanted now, it would die. So while researching on how to save this tree, I learned that the overflow pond pipes, I know they have a technical name, but that lead from the field would also flow into our native frog pond, which is also the solar panel pond. I also researched a little bit more in the short time on artificial turf. And although this is organic infill or crumb, my understanding is that maintenance could also include fungicide, occasional herbicide, and that the composite might have a hydrocarbon plastic composite. Because the school is exempt from an EIR and exempt from the city's tree commission, the community should know exactly what will be entering our waterways. This is also immediately next to Nathanson Creek. So let's support our sports, definitely. I'm all there for it. But let's also share in the care in regards to our neighbors and to our agriculture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. My name's Carolyn Brown. I apologize in advance. I'm a little nervous. And so forgive me, I'm just gonna read my prepared speech. I actually have one question about Adele Harrison Middle School, and I might have missed it in the presentation, but I didn't see any mention of air conditioning facilities being installed in the gym. And that was a big issue when, you know, I was PTO president there, but also for our kids, they have, you know, athletic events in there, they've got their gym practice, but they also have dances. And my kids don't want to go to the dances because they're hot and sweaty and really difficult to be in that room with kids, with so many people in there, never mind people who are moving. So I have two more comments about the athletic fields, and one is sort of about a community participation. At this level, at the high school level of children's education, parents are already less inclined to help out, and the school desperately needs volunteer help, especially for the athletic events. And having to travel an hour each way just to go to a home meet where you would need to be helping out, which is what they're looking for, is volunteers, parent volunteers, and community volunteers to help out during a home meet. This is a huge setback in obtaining volunteers, and it pushes parents away. This weakens our community ties, and community is what Sonoma is all about. It also discourages kids from joining a team at an age where they really need to be doing sports and getting exercise. And there's no debate about that. We all know that there's a huge correlation between athletics and academic performance. Furthermore, when my son does go to a home meet all the way in Santa Rosa, we have to clean up afterwards, and he doesn't get home till very late at night, and then he has homework to do. And this results in an impossible situation for him. Not enough time to do homework, not enough sleep, and wasted hours spent traveling to a home meet. Another thing I wanted to discuss was the environmental impact of a turf field. And I am no, you know, expert on this, but having done a little research, I know that it helps to conserve water. It helps in times of drought, and I know this winter was not an example of that, but we have had that issue, and we probably will be having it again. No mowing means no gasoline runoff into the water. No pesticides or herbicides would need to be used, which would reduce harmful chemicals in the immediate environment. And you know that the materials are 100% organic, and this reduces landfill and chemical waste. There are many reports available, and I'm not, you know, the person to do this, but while we're talking about the environmental impact, just linking back to my comment about parents and volunteers helping out, remember that by making parents, teachers, students, and coaches drive in their cars all the way to Santa Rosa for an hour each way, that's 2 hours, and we're all using gasoline, and this contributes to greenhouse gases and creating global warming, and this would be diminished by having a suitable track here in Sonoma. So please give our students all the advantages that they can have and help us improve our track and fields. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask Kevin if he can interject here about air conditioning.
Sure. Actually, there's two things I'll briefly say. Talk about the turf infield again. It is, we are going with a cork. We're not doing a chrome rubber. So it is 100% organic. It comes from virgin cork from trees that are harvested every 9 years. So we don't have to worry about the runoff into the streams.
There was also a question about the herbicides or pesticides like that. I'm not familiar with that.
No, not on the turf fields themselves. As far as air conditioning, the district actually doesn't have air conditioning in any of their gyms or multi-use rooms. To cool those facilities is a huge cost. So it's typical of most multi-purpose rooms and gyms to not air condition them.
Before Mr. Chapin leaves the podium, though, I had one question about that synthetic issue. Not as to the infill, just as to the material that constitutes the fabric itself. Mm-hmm. What's that material made from?
Yeah, it's a plastic material. That's a carpeted material.
Right. I mean, so there, even though the material itself, the infill is organic, the field material, the turf itself is synthetic, right?
Correct.
Yeah, okay. That's all. Thank you.
Yeah.
Two things. First of all, I've gone on record, and I'll go on record again, stating we do not use pesticides on our school district. That was one thing that we actually got away from. We use for the weeds, we use soap vinegar. And we're actually starting to put some soap salt in there because found out that really takes care of the issues too. So just want to put that to bed. The second issue that we have is we had Jay Takis from 10,000 Inc., which is a air conditioning firm come in, and they went to Adele Harrison. When Adele Harrison was originally built, the gym in there has 8 different exhausts of fans, from the vents that come out. Each one of those vents aren't doing their job. If you look up there, you see that the nozzles are in different directions where they're actually supposed to be facing each other, so they hit, come down and around, so which is creating the poor circulation. And it's kind of interesting because on my summer to-do list for the maintenance crew, it's actually to get the lift in there and change those out. So that, we hope, will take care of the issue. I just want to go on record and explain that stuff. So,
thank you.
Hi, I'm Lori Winter, and I have a daughter who just graduated from Adele, 8th grade. And I wanted to support Carolyn's comments that I feel like prioritizing this as something to be done here and to stop all this running all around the county, I'm really in favor of that. Also, I find myself having a personal reaction if I hear people separate athletics from education, because my daughter plays volleyball with that girl, and I have seen Cameron and my daughter and other girls just grow from their experience. So the growing the whole person, the health, the fitness, the physical activity, the teamwork, the using the mental skills that you need to be in athletics, I think is a huge part of a person's education if they choose to do that. And then if you're not an athlete, I wasn't an athlete in high school, but I went to every football game, every basketball game. The sense of community that the athletic facilities will create is going to benefit athletes and non-athletes alike and the families of athletes and non-athletes. So I know that these are very talented designers that are going to figure out the scale, the details. I'm not worried about that, but I do just want to support the prioritization where you have it right now. The only other thing that I would love to see move up would be a quad. So there's more of a heartbeat of the school again. So the kids, again, back to the point of community, have a place to really build their community, spend time together, have events, eat lunch, not have to go find their little parts of the campus at lunchtime. So if you'd consider that. So thank you.
Thanks, Lori.
Hi, my name is Cindy Studdert. I have a 2012 graduate and a daughter entering eighth grade at Adele Harrison this year. I have coached soccer at the varsity and the JV levels. I play soccer on those fields all the time, futsal in the gym. My husband plays basketball 3 times a week in these gyms. I want to thank you for your leadership and your vision for the future of our schools. One issue that I don't think has been addressed is when people talk about security. As a coach of freshmen and sophomores, these are children who cannot drive themselves to school. If they live, you know, where most kids in this town live, like my daughter, she cannot ride her bike to school. So if the coach is not on campus and can't have practice right at 3:30, those kids need to be there. They can't leave and get brought back. Kids don't get to play if it's not on campus. Their parents can't do it. We don't have a municipal bus system to allow for it to happen. And while it seems a stone's throw and a simple thing to think about Arnold Field, which I happen to love, as an adequate site for a stadium, it is by definition not. It cannot be expanded to be large enough to actually, Arnold Field is not even a regulation football field. It's shorter in the last 10 yards if you measure it. Don't tell NCS, or they won't let us host events there. And when you have the stadium on campus, it's not just the athletes who participate. It's the marching band. It's the dancers. It's the kids who will come because it's convenient. I really appreciate the neighbors who have brought up other issues. I've expected a more self-centered attitude, and I really appreciate that your stance is coming for our kids and that you want the best for them. And while I would like everything for our children, I believe the priorities of these athletic facilities should go sooner rather than later, and thank you so much for your leadership.
Could I ask for a show of hands of how many speakers we have lined up? How many people want to speak yet? I can't see that far. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All right, 10. I'll tell you what, can we get a minute each and try to get you all in? Because we have to go through all the elementary schools. So it's going to have to be bottom line stuff here. I apologize for that.
Point of order.
Please go ahead.
Point of order.
Good.
One moment. Perhaps it might be best if the elementary schools have their own session, because the issues tonight are so focused on the issues of the athletic facilities at the high school.
You know, we're going to have another chance to speak on this when we vote on it, although that's pretty late in the process. You can also email us, phone us, accost us on the – we have to get that done. And so if we can just proceed here, cut to the bottom line, please don't try to repeat anything that has already been said, but just basically give us the basics. Thank you.
This is probably a bad way to start then, but my name's Roger Pritchard, and I just wanted to say something, and I think it's probably been covered in various ways. My wife and I are new residents in Sonoma and enthusiastically supported Measure E. We want to live in a community where the children get the best education they possibly can, and that includes a safe and enjoyable athletic experience, as I had when I was at high school. Our only question really is a 2,500-foot seat stadium overkill? Is there a cheaper and better way to do it which will leave funds for other things that the school may need more? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Austin Arrington. I'm going to be a junior at the high school this next year. Sorry, I'm not very prepared, but I didn't think I was going to speak today either. Basically, I have a couple things to bring up. Playing on the freshman field and the JV field, I've noticed safety issues, more than safety issues. Rattlesnakes, 2 injuries I've suffered, one on my hand, broken collarbone. A friend of mine, Cole Morgan, took a ground ball to the face right there. Teeth went through. It was gnarly. But I like to consider myself a bright student.
I just can't seem to understand why we put a fig tree before our students' safety. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks. Nikolai Matheson. I'm a resident nearby the high school. I'm about 137 yards as the crow flies. Just wanted to say I really appreciate the process. All of our input is part of the process. You're weighing it. Thank you for some of you taking notes. What we have to say means something, and that means something to us. And I trust the process, and I trust what you're doing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. Joe Fichtenberg. You have to forgive me. I'm a little nervous. I didn't plan on speaking, but I felt I needed to say something. I do work at the high school. I'm a student activities office. That is not why I'm here. I'm also a mother. My son is at Adele. He is totally into athletics, and I would love for him to have the best facilities possible. But that's not really why I'm up here talking right now. I'm talking up here as an alumni. I graduated in 1990, wore my alumni shirt. I'm proud to be a Dragon. I've always been proud to be a Dragon. I have moved away from Sonoma several times, and I've always moved back because this is my hometown. Our facilities for our athletes are an embarrassment. I have seen other schools, just neighboring counties and our own counties, and the pride that they show in their students by giving them suitable facilities makes it hard to be proud to be a Dragon. So please put this at top of your list. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kathy Murphy, and I am a parent of three that went through the high school and one that's there now. I'm also an employee at Prestwood. I'm a mentor, and I'm also a neighbor of the high school. And I walk my dogs on a leash, and I pick up. And I just know that we all benefit from these fields and these open spaces, and as a neighbor, I'm passionate about it, and I'm passionate about these kids, and I want to keep them safe, warm, dry, and active.
Thank you.
My name's Andrew Ryan. I'm a vice principal at Sonoma High, and as importantly, I have three young children in the district who will possibly benefit from all of these facilities conversations. To address two things, really. The idea of warm, safe, and dry, what safety means to a district, to a site, is quite a breadth, and it's a big deal. Part of that has to be safe athletic facilities for our students to practice in, which you've heard about. Part of it is providing a safe environment for them to host home games and senior nights, so not traveling all over the county to have those. Part of that also is the safety of every single one of our 1,300 students that take PE and have to use these facilities as well. There's also, I appreciate the community's support, concern's not the right word, but certainly support for the academic programs at the high school and the academic facilities. And I want to say that that's fantastic, the outpouring of support and comments about that. We have students attending some of the top colleges across the country, some of the top state universities and private schools and UCs, some of the great CTE and training schools and junior colleges. I think it's probably time that our athletic facilities catch up to what our academic offerings are at the high school. Thanks.
Thank you.
You out. Hi, my name is Dan Morgan, alumni Sonoma Valley High School. I'm wondering if you guys were around, maybe Luann, yes, Sal, in the 80s and 90s when we had great football teams and the place was absolutely packed. The 600 to 800 does not complement that. We need the 2,500. We need it.
Good afternoon, Tony Mall. Just going to try to stick to the notes that haven't been touched. Speaking about that fig tree at Adele, has there been a figure that's been discussed to move it? Because trees of all size can be moved, and it might be something we can get the community to wrap around to do that. Obviously, yeah, a beautiful tree of that size, why waste it? But there should be another resource to move it to safe and securely to another site. Also with Altamira, not talking about elementary schools, you know, we still need to focus up Valley. All schools are important. And being an alum of Altamira, I would love to see much resources being used there and utilized, especially that the track there too. That's a horrible, horrible field. And then with the high school, we just can't forget the education, life skills, and positive health benefits that a superb athletic facility can provide. And truly, Arnold Field is not suitable for anything but baseball. We all know that. I'm born and raised here, like many of us in this room. I played football there since Pop Warner, and it's always been a horrible, horrible field for football. As it was said, it's not even of regulation size. And truly right now, at halftime, the kids have to go over and use the Little League bleachers. They don't even have a blackboard to write and make corrections on to try to win a game. So I think we need to consider that since there's not even a facility there for them to go into and change. They have to be bused there. Truly a multi-purpose athletic facility with the new track and sport turf that can host playoffs and tournaments would only be the right fit for Sonoma. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Alice Shim. I'm the Boosters president of Sonoma Valley High School. And I just want to say that I am just appalled at the condition of our athletic facilities. They have not kept up with the world-class town that we live in. And as Joe said, I am so embarrassed by our facilities. My fourth child is going through the high school. She is a junior, so I've seen the facilities just deteriorate consistently over the last years, and it's time we do something about it. Arnold Field is disgusting, and I challenge anyone to go to a football game this fall and try to tell me what the score of the game is. It's so embarrassing. The lights are out, and the owners don't do anything about it. The last organization that did something about that was Junior Dragon several years ago to replace the lights. So we cannot count on the owners of that field to do anything. So thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm John Greenslade. You know, just for safety concerns, Arnold Field is terrible. If we had a basketball field where you had divots in it and where kids purposely wouldn't run that way because they would lose their traction, you'd replace it. If we had classrooms where you had old chairs and lights that were so rusted they might fall down, you'd replace it. A lot of times athletics, we don't think about injuries because that's just kind of the part of the sport. But, I mean, Arnold Field is a completely unacceptable field to have our kids playing on. So I think safety being one of the main concerns of the school, that should take precedence, and I think you guys are giving it appropriate consideration. And the other part that just kind of makes me sad is athletics is a huge part of our education for our kids. You look at classrooms now, and what they're trying to do for the 21st century is teach teamwork, right? You're trying to do team stuff in the classrooms. Well, what's sports? It's teamwork. There's hundreds of kids, if not thousands. I mean, the high school only has 1,500 kids, but a lot of them play sports. There's certainly hundreds of kids that play sports. That's part of their education. It's a valuable part of their education. And like Ms. Stoddard said, there's a lot of kids. Both the parents work. They can't get there. If we can do that all in one area, all at one time, right after school, we can get a lot more kids participating in this community, which would be great. And then just the last thing along those lines, just for meeting rooms, if we could do this, if you are going to have future meetings, if you could do it in a bigger room, like the Altamira Gym or something like that, where everyone can fit. Because there's a bunch of people out there that like this and want to hear this. And I know this is nicer. It's air conditioned. You've got the things. You'd have to use poster boards instead of TVs. But at least everyone could fit and see and be in the same room. Thanks.
You mean like perhaps a 400-person performing arts center?
Could you? We have time for two more speakers.
First of all, my name's Tony Tomasi, and I want to thank all of you for serving. I got two questions that I didn't know if were answered. First, it showed a pool, and I didn't know how many lanes were in the pool. I have three children, my wife and I. Our youngest is in seventh grade, so most likely she won't see any of this either. But there is a tremendous amount of kids that do swim. Again, the boys won the league third time in 3 years. The girls won. That's the first time in 23 years that both boys and girls won the league without a pool. There's 50 kids out at the Aquatic Center. Soon, there'll probably be quite a few more kids in Jane's pool playing water polo. Is this pool going to accept water polo. Whatever's happening at Splash will not. And I know we won't be able to do it. So please, this is a sport, this water, the two sports, the swimming and the water polo, are really moving forward at Sonoma High. No one's mentioned anything about swimming, but I just hope that that can be a priority for these kids. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mike Bobbitt. I live at the end of Larkin Drive, right next to the Ag Center. I work in agriculture. I support agriculture. I'll try to get the easy ones done first and then hit the harder one. The first thing, the site plan proposes two compost areas. I don't know if they're intending that to be the vegetation material or the animal waste. The original agreement with the school district, or at least the original mitigations that we had, were that the animal waste would be moved off-site, would be stored in a covered container and moved off-site to mitigate noise or flies and smells. That hasn't been done for the last couple years. So the trailer broke and never got resolved. But as far as the those compost areas, I would like to see that dealt with differently. The other thing is the classrooms there. They really don't get utilized because it takes too long for the kids to go across the field. The underlying issue is that the Ag Center was put in the wrong place when it was built, but that's a done deal, and we're living with it. I think that was it. So yeah, so as far as moving the classrooms, as far as putting an arena there or a show arena and replacing those removing those classrooms, putting a show arena there, I think that's probably a good use of that space. Putting a shop back there and additional classrooms that are never going to get used, I think you should reconsider. The second thing, the athletic facilities. I totally support my daughter, my current wife, her daughter, our children, our grandchildren are at Prestwood now. So I totally support improving those facilities. I do not support having lights and significant size bleachers. There's going to be noise, lights, parking is going to be a I think that has been identified that there's not enough parking for a 2,500 seat arena. So I totally support the idea of pursuing Arnold Field. Yeah, maybe it's short, maybe the lights are out, maybe it's but that you're about to spend a whole bunch of money to do improvements. Why not improve those to the community where the rest of the community beyond just the school district can benefit from those in another way. My last point is safety. I think you need to also consider the safety of the neighborhood. Some of you may know, my first wife, was hit by a high school student going to school on Valentine's Day, 1994. She died. So you're talking about putting more traffic in a residential area where there are kids playing and pets and everything else, and you're talking about putting more traffic. What's the first place that people are going to try to park at that for a stadium? It's going to be at the Ag Center. So that's, we already have more than, well, from my dead end street before the Ag Center was there, the traffic on Larkin Drive is 100%. So now you're talking about putting more people down that street. Also, later in the evening, if they're coming to lit games, there's going to be happening in the dark and at dusk when there's that much more potential for accidents. So I think you should consider the safety of the neighborhood as well as the safety of all the students. Thank you.
Thank you. That's going to have to do it now. I really appreciate we ran a little long, but I think it was worth it, and we appreciate it. We're going to have to race through the grade schools, but I think we can do that. Most of the board has seen them. But first, pardon me? Oh, go ahead, Kevin.
A couple points of clarification from comments I've heard. First, the seating capacity is based on NCS requirements. The pool design is 8 lanes, and it also has a, it's designed for 25-yard swimming with a movable bulkhead. They'll allow it to be used for water polo. So we have designed it and laid it out so it can accommodate both.
Great.
And then parking, we have investigated and looked into between Adele, Presswood, and the high school. You can fit around 700 vehicles on those three sites.
Okay.
That's not including any street parking.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
And can I just ask a quick question?
Sure.
We were all at graduation on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
How many people fit in Arnold Field right now, those bleachers?
I don't know the bleach, how much? In the bleachers.
Do we have any idea? I mean, right, because it was beyond capacity,
yes.
Not just the bleachers, there was people standing around. And so while maybe a football game wouldn't draw 2,500 people, there is an occasional event like a graduation where we might, and I just don't know what the numbers are. I wondered if anybody had an idea.
Well, I mean, we can kind of break it down a little bit. Kathleen, how many students do we have graduate? Okay, so roughly about 300. We as a maintenance crew set up 1,600 chairs. And John was out there carrying one at a time, thanks. But he
two,
was out there, he was out there, you know, helping. But 1,600 chairs minus the 300, I mean, you're looking at 1,300 chairs that people were sitting in. Okay, and there were more people in the stands.
Right, that's the reason. Right. I was just trying to get some sense. I really have no idea. So 1,300 chairs, which were all full, plus full bleachers, plus standing people, both sides. So, okay.
As a former student athlete for the high school or for this district, I think that what Andrew hit on it, Tony hit on it, a lot of people hit on it. I think the correlation between, or the relationship between athletics and education, I think is being missed by a lot of the commentary that I heard. Quite frankly, one of the biggest parts of my life and my successes came because of sports and relationship to wanting to do well in the classroom. And I can speak on behalf of a lot of my friends that was the case for them as well. One of the things that stands out to me is that Arnold Field now is, and this is a great thing, I think, is Stomper's Land, right? Like, we have a baseball team now that took it over. It was never ours, and it never will be. I think having a facility like this on campus is, it was due a long time ago, and I reaped the benefits of a athletic facility at our high school, but not a great one, and we made the best of it. But I think this kind of investment is in line with how many student athletes there are, right? So I think that when we talk about this isn't a good investment, potentially it's a lot of money, $8 to $10 million. Well, we're talking about $120 million that Measure E granted us. This is less than 10%, and I guarantee there's more than 10% student athletes. Additionally, there's 100% of the students that do PE, physical education, that do need those great facilities. In terms of lights and the usage that will, this field will, when they're turned on, that's going to be less than 10% of the year, because I know there's less than 36 home games for football and soccer. So I think that we're very much in line with numbers. I just don't think we're looking at it correctly because we have slight bias, and that's great. Arnold Field is a convenience for many, but an inconvenience for many more. So the time is now. The athletic facility that's going to be done with a nice improved weight room, I think what we'll gain from that is going to be amazing. Partially why we might not have good enough football teams is because we don't have great facilities or great athletic training facilities for these student athletes to immerse themselves in some nice weight training or what have you with a lot of pride. Most campuses that we go on have that. They're branded. They're the colors of the school. There's kids in there supporting each other. We lack that. And that's been since I've been there. I mean, I was a kid that stole the key to make sure I got in the gym to put up more shots, and I got in trouble for it. So I know, you know, there was not enough access to this stuff for these student athletes, and we need it. So I'm excited for it. I understand all of the issues that it presents. It's tough. It's a tough balance act to make everyone happy, and we never do. I think we never will. We're always evolving, but this is, in my opinion, the right step for not me and not you guys, but well, some of you guys out there, but you know, it's going to be for the future. And so I'm happy for that. And that becomes kind of a selfless decision in that sense. So I'm proud of that.
And I just have one super quick question. So can the district spend money on property we don't own, since we don't own Arnold Field, right?
My understanding is no, we cannot, but I'm wondering if Trustee Kelly has done some research into that, or I know that there was some conversation that happened at the high school master planning, one of the community meetings, and so I don't know if he can elaborate or give us information on that.
But why don't you go ahead and I'll come, because I'm going to address it too, so I mean, if you want to get your questions out.
My only last question, sorry.
Cool.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, so we're doing $120 million of projects in 120 minutes, and that's fast. And these are projects that we're going to be paying off for 30 years. So I feel, first of all, that we may need more time to consider the elementary schools in more detail, since we have so many sites, and so much of this meeting has already been taken up by the high school master plan and middle school master plan at Adele. So I'm concerned we don't have adequate time at this point to deliberate concerning the elementaries. That's the first point. Second point is, I have specific questions about a couple of different items relating to the master plan at the high school, but they relate to there are some people in the room who we don't normally get here in the room, who it's very nice to have tonight because they have sort of unique information about what we as a district can do from a planning perspective. We have Mr. Bert Whitaker here with us tonight from our county regional parks, and he's our new director, I believe, of the department. It's very nice to have you here. Thank you for coming down tonight. It's very much appreciated. We also have Jennifer Gray Thompson from Supervisor Gorin's office here. Thank you very much for coming. It's very much appreciated. We also have Mary Favreau here tonight from the Sonoma Valley Health and Recreation. Do I call that association? Did I get it right? Thank you for coming. And that's helpful because they've done an extensive amount of work on the costs of operating a pool going forward, which is an issue we've touched on just barely tonight, but we are considering including in our master plan the construction of a facility that has significant operating costs going forward, which I haven't heard a lot of discussion about yet, and I'd like to get to that. I'd actually like to hear from all three of those people, and if we're going to truncate our public comments such that they don't have an opportunity to speak, I'm concerned we haven't fully addressed the issue. Then I did see that our high school principal, Ms. Kathleen Hawing, is here tonight, who looked like she had some comments she'd like to make too, and before we finish tonight, I would actually like to hear from her too. But I mean, I'm going to finish up the stuff that I plan to say. I mean, I think we can make a decision after that about where we go. Well, there's a couple more. The fig tree issue seems to me to be one that is within the scope and sort of like reasonable exercise of discretion by our construction manager. That seems to be something that we can delegate, that you guys, you know, meeting with the affected faculty at the school site. From what I've heard from Yannick, that they're not opposed to the idea of moving the tree, that is something that they believe actually is possible to do. Sort of a very different problem from the legacy oak that we had at Flowery. It's sort of the different side of the coin. So that seems to be one that is one that we can address, but it may not be something that's really part of the master plan process tonight. So, and I see some nodding, so that's good. It's really nice to see Ms. Stephanie Jordan here tonight for Sonoma SC. Thank you for taking the time. It was fun to help incorporate that organization with you, and it's been wonderful to see the success that it's had since then. And I just want to thank you for taking the time to come out tonight and for your advocacy for soccer in general. I want to thank Ms. Cindy Studdard for coming out tonight. I thought that her comments, where she found common ground with the neighbors regarding the improvement of the athletic facilities and recognizing that there's far more that unites us in this room than divides us, was very positive, and I wanted to thank her for that. I wanted to thank all of the neighbors that spoke to the importance of athletic facilities and physical education. You know, understanding that there can be a disagreement about the scope or size of a stadium is a thing entirely separate from recognizing the importance of physical education. And I think all the neighbors did do that, and so I want to thank you for all of that. It's very much appreciated. You know, I wrote a few words one time about how powerful and what a nice idea a high school stadium can be. And after doing that, I spent a lot of time talking with the baseball community here in Sonoma Valley. We have Mr. Rich Blanchard here tonight from the Sonoma Valley Athletic Club, who's also a JV baseball coach. And there's other members of the baseball community here too. And they're very committed to the sort of special nature of Arnold Field and how it impacts baseball. And that sort of gets to, I think, the core of this sort of issue that we're talking about tonight, which is there are some sports that are very oriented towards towards nature, towards grass, towards having that natural surface. And baseball is the quintessential one, where Field of Dreams is in our minds, right? I mean, it's a movie, but it's a wonderful idea, too. Whereas soccer has transitioned to a time where it is year-round and requires facilities of a different nature, and that's why we investigate synthetic surfaces. And if we come to a situation where, say, perhaps baseball can continue to utilize the grass at Arnold, where it's already there, and where we can put in facilities that do aid the soccer community and other communities at the high school, it's not an unreasonable compromise, and it might be a basis for some common ground here. I want to thank Tony Moll for his comments regarding football. I feel like having his unique experience regarding the importance of adequate facilities is well taken, and so it's nice to have our community members who have very deep expertise on the subject come out tonight and advise us. So thank you. Speaking with Ms. Mary Favreau prior to the meeting, my understanding from her is that the approximate costs of operating a pool going forward is about $130,000 a year, and that is not for operations by people, but that concerns things like utilities, chemicals, and necessary supplies. And when we're in a position where we are facing a serious deficit, adding additional capital projects that have operating expenditures going forward is of concern, and is something that I would like to see us have additional detail provided on. The comments concerning the safety of the roads and our athletes traveling were especially poignant to me. This is the last month, we had a young mother lose her unborn child in an accident on Highway 12, and continuing to make sure that the safety of our athletes is just a paramount concern to us. My own wife is pregnant right now, traveling Highway 12, and the idea of our students or our children getting hurt driving that road is horrifying, or any of the other roads in the area, so it's a well-taken concern.
Were you going to address the notion of Arnold Field?
I am. I mean, okay, the consideration of whether we can partner. So it's well known under California law that a school district can partner for recreational purposes with other agencies in a given area. And there's numerous examples throughout California where counties and cities partner with school districts to provide recreational facilities, recognizing the dual use, and the Parks and Recreation Code, our government code recognizes that and creates for the provision of these exact cooperative agreements. And we absolutely, of course, can spend monies to conserve resources when we are making sure that a particular facility is dual use. Now, that's a significant problem, though, because we are not the Parks and Rec Department for the Valley. It's our secondary mission, not our primary mission. And oftentimes, we are looked to resolve these issues. We can partner, and we can make sure that our athletic facilities are capable of satisfying our demands while at the same time making sure that they're for the benefit of the community. But in some respects, I think we have to turn to the county and to our city itself to provide us with the facilities that we really need. The county's been engaged in a master planning process for the Maxwell Farms, putting in three potential soccer fields at that location. And that would be a transformation for our soccer community if we did, in fact, get that. Unfortunately, they did not pass the measure that was intended to fund that, and the resources are not available. But it is my understanding that the county intends at some point here in the near future to seek to, again, fund the master plan at Maxwell, which would have a significant effect. And we could partner there, too, to reduce the impact at the high school complex. So, I mean, the law does provide for us to be able to partner. But the investigation would be necessary to do that. We have not yet done that investigation. And we did via our staff tell the community that we would conduct that investigation. So, I mean, that's not something that necessarily needs to take a very long time, right? That can be something that's brief. We can do that in a 90 to 120-day window. And I don't think that we necessarily have to abandon plans for the high school just based upon the fact that we're going to do an investigation. But we do need to do that investigation and resolve the question. And I mean, like I said, I would like to hear from the people that I referenced specifically before we move off this and move to the elementaries. But thank you.
John, can I just clarify? So you were saying about the baseball that perhaps Arnold Field might be utilized for our high school teams?
I mean, it seems to me that if we're looking for a situation where we address the needs of all the constituencies, and that's one of the reasons it was nice that the baseball community came out tonight and appreciate them being here, is that baseball does seem like, especially varsity baseball and perhaps even JB baseball, prefers to remain at Arnold. That's my understanding from speaking informally with the members of the different teams. They do seem pleased by the idea of a freshman field being located at the high school. There are also additional concerns, as I understand it, where JV softball and the current alignment of the baseball fields may have overlapping distributions of balls based on where the home plates are. So, but it did seem like a compromise to that, again, sort of congestion at the high school facility was if merely freshman baseball remained at the high school and then JV and varsity moved and remained sort of at Arnold Field. Now, there's other interested parties at Arnold Field that we can partner with beyond the county. I mean, the Stompers do have a longer-term interest there, and they're actually, you know, I mean, there's an investment that's being made there. So I think there's the potential at Arnold to certainly satisfy some baseball concerns. Now, the sticky wicket is football. I do understand the concerns about, I think Salvador, Trustee Chavez's point that you know, if you want to have a successful football program, improve your football facilities. I mean, it's a well-taken point. There is, I think, as part of the investigation at Arnold Field, if we can determine if we can get adequate facilities for football there, again, in like a 90 to 120 day window, we can put the issue to rest and we can say, okay, it'll work or no, it won't, and we can move on. But I do think we have to have finality. We're going to have to make a decision about where we're going because we can't have the status quo prevailing in the long run. We have to make sure we have the adequate facilities.
So are you representing anybody that's involved in Arnold Field? It's my understanding.
Sure. On a charitable basis, I've been the attorney for the Sonoma Valley Athletic Club since 2007, which is a 501c3 that operates sort of the field. The club itself was founded in 1905, and it has operated that field since, I think, 1957. To the extent that I'm involved with them, I'm not a board member. I don't have any discretionary authority about the exercise of their authority.
So what do you do?
I a lawyer.
So it was my understanding that you said that you negotiated on behalf at the meeting that was held to discuss the high school master plan, that you were in negotiations. Is that true?
I'm not quite sure what the newspaper reported, but I do know that at that meeting that, you know, I've met previously with Mr. Bert Whitaker, who is here tonight, and we've discussed, you know, is this the core mission of the county regional parks to be operating places like Arnold Field? And one of the reasons the athletic club exists operating that facility is because of the fact that they are regional parks. They are not a park and rec department. And we previously in the valley had a parks and rec department, and we disestablished it some time ago, about 25, 30 years ago. And those resources had to go to someone at that time. This includes Larson, for example. And so they fell to regional parks by default. That's not their thing. You know, I mean, things like Sonoma Valley Regional Park or, you know, Hood Mountain, these are the things that agency is, you know, configured to operate. So, I mean, in the long run, you know, I always think that the city is the optimal person to operate Arnold Field. I mean, it seems like a city park. It looks like a city park. I think Healdsburg's is involved in their Veterans Park. But, you know, if we're going to accept this role as the Parks and Rec Department, you know, okay. I do think, though, that we should, I mean, pulling the city in here makes some sense, too.
So who are you negotiating with?
I'm not negotiating with anybody right now, Dan.
Oh, well, I thought was what you said back at that meeting.
I don't recall you being there.
Well, this was reported to me that you said so.
Well, who told you?
I can't recall.
Well, as I said, I've talked with Bert about this.
I think you made some remark about why would we go out and buy a new sweater when we can repair the old one or something, and that you had indicated you were in negotiations and that there was a great potential for.
Well, that's why secondhand speech is always a bad thing to rely on, because, of course, I was talking about a hole in my coat, not a sweater.
Of course you were. Of course
you
were.
And the second thing is, of course, that I'm not going and I'm not negotiating on behalf of the school district with the county.
Okay.
I don't.
Well, then maybe we could ask Mr. Whitaker if the county has any interest in our, you know, working with you in a partnership to invest money in Arnold Field and improve it.
Yeah, thank you. Bert Whitaker, the director of Sonoma County Regional Parks. And, you know, listening, it's great to see a wonderful turnout here. And as John mentioned, we have been doing a lot of outreach for the Sonoma community over the last year and a half or so with Maxwell Farms and the master plan update. And it became very clear in that process in working with the community groups, the field users, and youth athletic organizations. In this part of the county, there really perhaps is not so much of a quantity issue with athletic fields, but it's really a quality issue. And certainly regional parks with Maxwell Farms, we have Ernie Smith, Larson, Arnold Field. All those facilities are, they're aging facilities. In the last decade, I've been in charge of most of the infrastructure of the county system, and it is in need of major reinvestment. I'm certain if Sonoma Valley Unified School District reached out to the county to have a discussion, we'd be happy to talk about it, but those discussions have not happened to date. To answer your question.
Are you aware of, you know, the legality of you know, do you think there's some promise of forming a partnership to invest money in Arnold Field? Is that?
We have not researched that. It's something that, if requested, we could certainly work with our county council office to get information on our position on it.
Well, we would love, because this keeps getting thrown up, but as far as we're, you know, the rationale that we've always operated with is that we have to invest in property that we own, that we can't go out and sort of willy-nilly improve properties that we don't own. So, excuse me. I'm sorry, maybe you have a comment for that?
No other comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Sal?
I feel like they're two separate issues anyway. You know, we have something that we're working on that's much more important, I think, than just repairing Arnold Field. Arnold Field has been messed up for a long time. I mean, there's not many other. So the convenience or the timing of a conversation to fix it seems ridiculous right now. I mean, you know, we're getting to a point where we finally can own something. We can say it's ours, and we can I mean, this is might be a horrible example, but the students just won't battle the fans, and we show so much pride, and we don't even have a home field. And in this particular scenario, you know, I think first of all the county, the city should step up, period, independent of what we do, because this needs to happen and all our fields need to improve, period. More accessible. I think, to your point, absolutely, quality is at the top of the list, but quantity as well. I mean, we have so many people wanting to use fields these days, including adults, and they don't have access. And I've been sitting on the committee for, is it fields users or what have you, and every meeting it's about the holes and the twisted ankles and the lack of or not being able to use these fields. So I think both should happen, period. You know, one way or the other, they both the county and city should step up, and then we need to step up as well.
To that point,
The interests of our elementary schools, I very much apologize that they're going to get about 5 minutes each, but I tried to warn us at the beginning of this meeting we're going to be jammed tonight all the way up probably till midnight. I want to thank all of you.
Whoa, can we please finish our deliberation? I would like to respond to Trustee Chavez's comment.
I have the floor.
Okay, may I please have the attention of the
all right,
president?
Your response, and please make it quick.
So, I mean, I hear you I hear him saying we don't have a home. But the thing about Arnold Field is, it's not like it's all of ours, right? I mean, this is the community legacy that we've inherited from the veterans who put their time in out there, from generations of people who've devoted resources, from charities that have gone out there to do improvements. And it's careful and it's cautious. Now, we have 200 million plus of projects. I'm not saying that we don't want to improve the athletic facilities, because we do want to improve them. And I'm not saying actually at the end of the day it may very well be that we can't do something at Arnold Field, but we have a duty to investigate it, to make sure that we're cautious when spending money. So I'd say let's take the 90 or 120 days, investigate it. I think we hear from the county, they're saying they're open-minded to talking to us. Let's make the effort. 120 days, these are 30 years of projects we're talking about.
I have to say that characterizing this as 120 minutes to $120 million, this process has been going on since 2011. So I'd like to enter that in, and I'd like to get on with a discussion of the elementary schools. We have to go about 6:15 to close session, but we're willing to run right up next to it.
Okay. So I will speed through these. Luckily, most of these have not changed dramatically. So I'll start at the top of the valley and kind of work my way down. So we'll start off at Dunbar. It's the existing school as it is now. We have re-roofed. We've modernized their kitchen. And we've repaved a lot of the campus and their playgrounds and in their parking lots since 2011. So we have done some improvements. We are scheduled to replace all their heating and cooling next summer. So we have done a lot of the warm, safe, and dry at that campus. And so in meeting with them, a lot of their priorities are exactly the same, focusing on expanding their multi-use room to make it more usable, adding a stage to it, adding storage to it so they can remove chairs and put them outside of the multi-use. Fixing acoustic problems in their multi-use room, fixing their admin to add some more storage space, and then replacing the aging portables. Some of those portables are just at the end of their lives. So between the 2011 and this current plan, we've replaced the portables that are down on this end and created parking and removed the parking that was shown originally in the oak trees and replaced all the portables, this six classrooms here, and then added an additional classroom that will be used for breakout spaces, IEPs, which was requested from the site. So kind of a larger plan of that multi-use room where we are adding the stage and storage. Some of the priorities, mainly is fixing acoustics in the NPR. When we were there, we were trying to do our public presentation. We couldn't talk to the people across the table from us. The acoustics are that bad in that gym. There is no acoustics. Everything is a hard surface in there. They brought up site security, site lighting. Since it's a pretty rural school, there is not a lot of exterior lighting at night. So they'd like to see some more lighting there. Bathrooms need to be fixed. Like I said, they needed an extra classroom for IEPs. They wanted something similar to like the portable that's at Altamira that houses all those facilities. And replacing all those classrooms because they are at the end of life and creating a new wing, so to say, out of those spaces. Then creating and updating their libraries. This is a common theme throughout all the elementary schools. They want to update their libraries into more media labs, 21st century libraries, and incorporate maker spaces into them as well. And the one thing their site council came up with is they would like to add some site fencing to the site because there's so much of that south end of the site and east end of the site that's along Dunbar that's so wide open. They would like to fence some of that to try to direct people up to the front of the school. They don't want to fence off the school, but they want to control flow to the school. So any questions on Dunbar? Okay.
How many people might have questions on the elementary schools that are here right now? Okay. That's probably even better.
Okay. So this is Flowery as it currently is now with the aging portables at the end and some older ones as well along the north side. The NPR and the admin. And this photo is obviously from last summer when they were doing the construction of the new parking lot. This master plan completely did not change from 2011. Only thing the Mentor Center is the only thing it moved. They reconfigured where some of the spaces are within it, but the master plan itself did not change. They would like to replace all their portables and extend the wings, and then create a whole new wing where some of the portable classrooms currently are. They are short on parking, as anyone who's been to that site knows. So they want to reconfigure the north parking lot to get some additional parking in there. They'd also like to modernize their multi-use. It is the only multi-use of all the elementary schools that does have a stage and is appropriately sized. So what they need is just storage space so they can get their tables out of it and to refurbish the gym because it is showing its age. So their priorities is mainly with student safety and parking. So they want to add some more walkways, more space behind the walkways at the drop-off so they can get more students out there and safely around out there. The additional staff parking, PA upgrades. The PA can't be heard throughout the school, so it's one of the safety features they wanted to do. And their big first priority is modernizing their multi-use room because it is showing its age. They want to get all the tables out of there. So that is their top priority. And then once again, it's the media lab updating their libraries. So like I said, it's a common theme throughout the elementary school, same thing with NPRs. Then adding some landscape between all the wings. This is any of the campuses that have wings ask for this as well, so they can create some outdoor spaces for the students in between the wings. Update their track, just like a walking path similar to what's proposed at Adele. Replace their classrooms is a big one as well because they are showing their age. They'll last for a little bit longer, but portables, like I said, have a limited life. And just some additional site features. Alvarado, existing with the multi-use and all the wings and their portable on the south side. When we first started meeting with Alvarado in 2011, the first thing that popped up was, again, their multi-use. Their multi-use is really small in size. They are one of the largest elementary schools with around 400 students. So they wanted a larger space. They wanted a stage. and looking at where we could, the only place you can really add a stage is would be on the back, but it's also where all the electrical for the whole entire site comes in at that location. So putting a stage there is not feasible. So the only way we saw that we could fix this is actually give them a new multi-use room. So we have a new multi-use room right where the portables currently are, and we'd have to relocate all the portables onto the asphalt area. In discussions with them, they would like to update where we're showing the grass at this location. They would like to expand more blacktop to regain what we're taking away from them there. And since then, multi-use rooms generally are the front of the school, we are also proposing to move the admin to the front of, over in between as well, and relocate the front of the school. One of the issues that we've heard out there is the current drop-off. It's hard to make a left turn because the drop-off is on a curve of that road. And so if we move the drop-off down to this location, it is a 90-degree out. So it's a lot better visibility. And we would move the buses up to the current drop-off. In discussions, what we could do with the existing multi-use room, it'd make a great library maker space. So we, if we turn that into the library, it'd make a real great space. And we could also gain back the space that the library currently is in this hall and convert it into two classrooms. So we gain two classrooms from that conversion as well. And their other big priority is to replace their kindergarten buildings. Currently, they have four kindergartens. Only this one is a site built. The other three are in portables. Two of those are your standard 960-foot portables, which are really too small for kindergartens, and they also lack bathrooms. At 960 square feet, you can't add them because it makes the room that much smaller. So they would like to replace those with site-built kindergartens. And so the list we got from their committee, once again, the biggest need is the multi-use room because that's where the most of the student need is. It's the biggest bang for their buck. They can't get their whole campus inside their multi-use at this point. So it is a major issue for that site. Then replacing those kindergartens, taking kindergartners to the restroom, it takes away from the learning because they have to be accompanied. So it's a hassle for the staff, not to mention the small size of those classrooms. Then they would like to make all the classrooms the same by adding water to them. Half the wings have sinks in them and half of them don't. So it would add sinks with bubblers so they have drinking fountains within their classrooms. They'd add like additional storage and teaching walls in their classrooms. They're the only school that asked for additional storage and fixing up their classrooms. And it's typical of most schools, they want AV upgrades and speakers. And then kind of the similar landscape and wing stuff as I described in the that are common and throughout the other campuses. Sassarini, as it is today with the fields and the parking lot on the south end, with the admin and the multi-use kind of in the middle of all the classrooms. Here I'm going to actually start with the priority list. When we met with them the first time, they said the master plan was fine, the way we designed it in 2011, and there was no real changes that needed to be done. When we met with them for the second time and got their priority list, there's a reoccurring theme in this priority list. There's about six items there that deal with a multi-purpose room, either adding on to it or fixing it. So we could do all those things and fix some of the issues they have. We might not be able to fix it perfectly, and we'd just be scabbing onto a building that's over 50 years old. So at what point does it make sense not to replace it? So we floated that idea at that second meeting, and they were very much in support of just replacing the multi-use room because we cannot fix it adequately. So we'd replace it exactly where it is, with a multi-use, a kitchen, a stage. There would be interior, exterior. So you have performances on the inside. You can roll up a door, and it's open to a stage that would be out on the blacktop as well. We'd also propose to expand their admin, which is also very small, and put some covered walkways between their portables to try to enclose it so students aren't getting wet in between, going in between rooms. And then put a walking path around the fields. In the 2011 plan, we did have additional parking on the south end of the site down here to help with drop-off. Since 2011, they switched where the buses and parents drop off. So the parents now drop off in the front, and the buses pick up on the street.
when meeting with them, they said the issue around drop-off has basically gone away when that switch. And the staff didn't feel that that parking was lot was needed anymore, and they didn't want to lose the field space. Because the additional parking down there, with all the majority of the classrooms on the north side, they felt wouldn't be used. So just kind of quick, added staff room and work room would be added to the admin with their mailboxes, once again, to bring the staff into the admin space every day. And that's just kind of a closer up view of that multi-use with the kitchen, the stage, restrooms, and storage. Presswood, as it is today, we are currently replacing all their HVAC this summer and re-roofing NPR and fixing the other parts of the roof. Over here, we did add a preschool last summer. So the master plan hasn't really changed too much from 2011 either. 2011, we had a new admin at the top here in between two drop-offs, the two existing drop-off spaces. And meeting with the site, they actually prefer to stay where they're at and expand their multi-use or their admin into what's now the computer room to make it a larger admin because they like being in the center of the campus. And then add on to their multi-use because this is another multi-use that's too small for their campus and does not have a stage as well. Their kitchen kind of spills over into that space, so it's a little too small. And then once again, replacing their portables with site-built buildings. It's kind of a larger view of it. So the multi-use, we would get rid of the kitchen, add on to the back of it, and then add a stage going towards MacArthur, where there's currently asphalt, and making a larger kitchen right at the front as well. We'd also add restrooms, because currently if there's no restrooms in that building, so if something's happening at during the evening, that's the only building that needs to be open so public can use restrooms as well. Also can be used by kids during the day. So their biggest concern, once again, it's a recurring theme throughout the elementary schools, is their multi-use room. That is their biggest use room on campus, and it lacks the facilities that it needs for their students. Secondary, they do need admin. That is a very tiny space. There is no workroom, which they would like to add on to that space. It does mean moving that computer space that we're trying to find a location for, possibly the YMCA or another space on campus. And once again, AV is another big issue on the elementary school campuses, as well as the middle school. Getting a front row system, getting smart boards or LCD projectors, but technology upgrades within the classrooms. And then smaller stuff, getting shade, and then replacing their portables is also a big one. Another recurring thing that comes across as a small one is adding bottle fillers. That was a recurring theme at all the elementary schools as well. Sonoma Charter School. This is actually a campus we've done a fair amount of work on since 2011. We've replaced one of their classrooms, their admin, and their resource room. Currently, we're re-roofing the existing building and replacing our HVAC. This is a campus that actually has quite a bit of need. Their use portables have reached the end of their lives. One of them, room 10, is leaking significantly bad. We're trying to do a fix to it this summer, but it's definitely a Band-Aid fix, so we'll give it a few more years. But that is a building that needs to go. One of the things they brought up is their multi-use room is too small for athletics. Currently, their basketball plays in Sevastopol for their games. So they asked for a new gym. So we can fit a gym, it's pretty tight, but we'd have to also put a stage onto this gym because the play box would have to be replaced with classrooms as well. The play box is also reaching towards its end of its life, so putting classrooms there is not a big deal instead of keeping the play box. So it's mainly this campus is just replacing the buildings they have to make adequate spaces. They also want to add on to their kitchen. They like their multi-use room, but it's not big enough for athletics. So they would like to be able to use it in other ways, possibly putting an accordion door so they could make it as a maker's space, but still have it available for to be fully open for a full lunch period. So that's kind of their priorities, is as replacing that room 10, modernizing their old buildings to create a maker space, create a staff lounge workroom, and then that new gym that's shown, and then fix that. Since that they got a new gym, then obviously the next one would modernize their multi-use to a new purpose. Then a couple more smaller site improvements. Woodland Star, as I talked about in Altamira, is on both sides of the fire line, so it kind of flows in, and it's hard to tell where Woodland Star ends and Altamira begins. So in both, we were trying to give them their own identities. Woodland Star actually had the most people show up to their public presentation. There was probably about 50 people that showed up. And so that first slide I showed you that we presented to Altamira for the master plan, after getting their input, we radically changed the layout of Woodland Star to this. So it still accomplishes everything that they wanted, but it brings the campus in a little bit closer. So we moved the fire lane a little bit further south, giving them visitor parking and staff parking, and putting all the classrooms on the south side of that fire lane. So right against that fire lane, we have a long student drop-off, so we fixed their drop-off by adding a long one there. We're giving a multi-use room that could have an outdoor-indoor stage on the side. So this should be able to hold their whole entire campus. Right now, their multi-use room is in a portable and can hold about 50 people, and it's tight. Next to it, we see it as a two-story building. That'd be a new admin. So it'd be twice the size of their current admin. It's that size so we can get all their resources that are currently in a portable across the street by Altamira into that same building. We'd also have a single classroom on the bottom and then two larger classrooms upstairs, which we'd see as like the seventh and eighth grade because they need those larger rooms to cover the sciences. And when meeting with the crowd, with the group, they wanted to create a large central space within the campus. And so we relocated their portable classrooms that are here to the edge and relocated all their kindergartens to the other side so we could create a large open space to create kind of a heart of the campus as that they wanted. So they have a long priority list. So basically they're focusing on one, student safety with drop-off parking. That was their main issue, and circulation, and improving site supervision for the admin, and then replacing getting that multi-use room and replacing some of their aging portables and giving themselves their own identity. Then it goes on to the some of the stuff that we just would have to do when we do modernizations, updating bathrooms and so on. And then they wanted to put into their list that they do want to expand their size by another 30 students. So we did provide an extra portable for that, if that's the decision they end up going with. So that was a lot to go through really quickly. So to kind of remind everyone what our next steps are is we're going to be meeting on June 20th to do a workshop. At that point, we will have costs for that, and we'll have timelines for each project. And so we'll be working with you guys. We'll help facilitate that meeting to help make the decisions of what projects get funded and when. So we'll come up with a main project list and implementation plan for when those are going to happen. And just to remind everyone, this will take 6 to 8 years. Even though the bond was passed for $120 million, we don't get that all at once. So there's bond sales that happen roughly every 2 years at about a quarter of that money. So it's a long process that will happen over quite a few years.
Any questions from the board?
Thank you so much to the three of you for meeting with me individually and explaining a lot of this stuff, and also for having such dedication to not just the linear usage of it, but how it flows within the community, helping each site to be able to talk with each of their groups. It was such a full process, and it really showed also with the landscaping, paying attention to that, paying attention to green technology, with our turf fields, for example, continuing not to use any pesticides. I love that. And the water bottle fillers, things like that. I love that you guys are bringing to us the indoor-outdoor stage and the multipurpose. That's brilliant. And it looks like every campus really likes that idea, too. And again, it wasn't just one person at a site, because our schools aren't just about one person. It's about the students from now until, you know, later. And so our grandchildren. And so it's great that we can all see things for each other and help each other and our schools working together too. And the point I wanted to make too is about the safe, warm, and dry that Tony spoke on, is that having safe facilities is warm, safe, and dry. And so, you know, we could give an example of an athlete that could get a scholarship to a Ivy League that it could ruin their chances if they get hurt and can't get that scholarship, for example, but not to mention that the parents are devastated if their kid gets hurt, and the child too, and then their academics go down. And I mean, we know all the reasons, and many people brought up points like that. Let's see. I wanted us to also keep in mind that technology has changed, and it keeps changing at a rapid pace. And so things like lights, there's directed lights now, and it doesn't spill out. And oftentimes, I think you can maybe speak on this about how you do studies, you put lights in there to see how far does it actually go out. And that was really exciting for me to learn as well when you were giving the presentation to me. So maybe you could just briefly talk about that afterwards. About kids staying out of trouble, of course. And finally, I want to remind everybody that education has four parts to it: academic, physical, social, and emotional. So it's the educating the full child. And that's what I am dedicated to continuing doing. And that's why I serve on this board as a volunteer. So thank you so much, you guys, for doing all your hard work.
So going forward, because we'll be revisiting this on June 20th, if you could just quickly check, and if anyone's listening, if there's any of these 80-year-old trees or whatever in any of that would need to be displaced. I mean, as we cost out the project, right, maybe put some factor in there, because these things are really difficult when we're 85% of the way and we're already on a schedule, and then if we can just be thoughtful about including the possibility that these things might come up, right?
We'll have design contingencies in all the projects built in, so we can address those issues as they come up.
I wanted to thank Trustee Ducrose for her comments, and I specifically on the comment of the effect of inadequate athletic facilities in terms of injuring students. It's just that it's devastating to families when kids get hurt doing sports, and it undermines the hard work that the student has done in the first place. And it's a very well taken point, so thank you. I wanted to thank the staff and Chapin for your hard work on preparing the master plans. I don't think everyone's aware that you not only did site master plan updates for the community, but you met separately with the staff of all the sites as well. And there were some pretty comprehensive changes, for example, to the Sassarini master plan based upon the comments that you got from the staff that were there. And that's a model for the kind of responsiveness that we want all of our school sites to enjoy from staff that come from the district. So I think that you guys just did a really nice job in soliciting those comments. And I mean, you could see the impact of the changes in the Sassarini master plan as a consequence. So thank you for doing that. And that's all I had to say on that.
Thanks very much, Kevin. I just wanted to add one thing I think is accurate, and that is that for the future, at least 15%, I believe, of the monies that are generated from Measure E will be set aside as a contingency fund. So that's like $18 million. So we know that roofs are going to wear out, and all this stuff is going to continue happening, but we are going to make provision to set aside money for that so that going out for a decade we can be covered on that issue, so or more. And thank you so much for your time. I'm sorry to rush everybody. This is a time that we were going to have public comment about anything not on this agenda right now, which is basically the master plan. Is there anyone that wants to speak? I'd love to have it happen for a minute, but any public comment? All right, thank you so much. If you want to see us again, we'll be back out in 15 minutes. So thank you for your patience.